Yang kemarin, ya.
I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believes. This gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in every part of this world as a testimony unto the whole creation, and then the end shall come. Dear friend, the gospel of Jesus Christ, preached in the power of the Spirit and received in faith and humility, is God's answer to every human need in this world and in the life to come. He who has the globe in his hands has power to meet every need of yours. He loves you. And he has sent to you the word of his love with power and might to meet the need of the whole man, spirit, soul, and body. I welcome you to this service inspired by the Spirit, with preaching inspired by the Spirit to meet every need of yours. Join us in our worship, in our praying, and in listening to God's word that meets our need and saves us to the uttermost. Good morning and welcome. Hello, everybody. It's a pleasure to meet once again online to worship, to pray, and to hear God's word. Once again, I welcome you all in the name of Christ our Lord. I trust that as we open our hearts in worship, we shall receive a blessing from the Lord. We shall be engaging Christ himself. He will meet our need to the uttermost. Spirit, soul, and body. Join us in our worship service this glorious summer morning, Pentecost Sunday, as we remember the time when the Holy Spirit was made available to all humanity. It's called to worship, and once again, you will not be heard, but God will hear you. So just respond as you see on the screen. And it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your old men shall dream dreams, your young men shall see visions. So I'll respond, the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon us, and rivers of living water shall flow out from us. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Let's join together as we sing the hymn, Father of Everlasting Love, talking about the Holy Spirit that has been sent unto us.
Your goodness and your truth.
carefully. We now continue as we pray prayers of adoration. Before Fred comes on to pray prayers of thanksgiving and adoration, can you, in your own way, in your own heart, every one of us, just raise up a prayer of thanksgiving to God in about a minute or so before Fred comes on? Everybody, just pray, adoring God, worshiping Him, giving Him thanks for all the good things that He has done for you. Fred, can you come on and pray, lead us in prayers of thanksgiving and adoration?
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we bow our hearts to you and pray. We give you thanks for all you have done, especially the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, and the precious gift of your Holy Spirit. We thank you for the beauty in nature, the air we breathe, your glory we see, for joy and health, friends and family, for your daily provision, roofs over our heads, your mercy and care. These are blessings that you graciously share to us. Thank you for this wonderful gift of life. Lord God, we thank you for your creation, for the wide sky and the blessed sun, the salted sea and the running water, for the everlasting hills and the never-resting winds, for these trees and the common grass under our feet, for our senses by which we hear the songs of birds and see the splendor of the summer fields. May you grant us a heart wide open to this beauty, and save our souls from being so blind to what you provided for us in your glory. Our Heavenly Father, we give thanks for the pleasure of gathering together virtually during this time. We give thanks for life, the freedom to enjoy it all, and all other blessings. We continue to pray for health and strength to carry on to try to live as you would want us. And we give you extra thanks for this special week. We thank you for Martha's life and thus far you've brought her. We thank you for giving us an opportunity to witness and celebrate with her this huge milestone. We continue to pray for her and her family. May your blessings abound unto them forever. And for the rest of this service, we commit unto you, and that you dwell amongst us, and that may your Holy Spirit guide us. We ask all this in the precious name of Jesus Christ, our Heavenly Father. Amen.
Amen. Confession is a place of victory, said one minister. We are all frail and fallible. And if we admit it before God, He gives us victory and blessing. Shall we look into our lives and see where we have grieved the Holy Spirit? Today we're talking about the Holy Spirit, where we have ignored Him, where we have resisted Him, where we have forgotten about Him, where we have not listened to His leading and guidance. Let us ask for forgiveness in every area of our lives where we have failed to live by God's holy and blessed standards, and trust in His mercies. In our hearts, let us confess our sins before God. You may bring your prayers to a close. Heavenly Father, we come before you with sorrow for all our sins and failures, particularly with regard to walking in the Spirit, not allowing the blessed Spirit to control us and to lead us, not listening to him, grieving him, resisting him, neglecting him, ignoring him. Forgive us that we have not grown up in you as we should, and we have not known you as we should, and we have not become as strong as you want us to be, and we have not been as faithful as you want us to be. We have not loved you as we should, and we have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. Be merciful unto us and grant us forgiveness, cleansing, washing in the blood, and let your grace abound towards us, that from henceforth we shall do better. We ask this in Jesus' holy name. Amen. We continue with the hymn, Lord, we believe to us and ours the promise of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is promised to us or to our children and unto everyone who the Lord our God shall call. Lord, we believe to us and ours. Chapter 2, verse 1 to 21, Don will read for us. Coming, Don.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
The Holy Spirit comes at Pentecost. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, it sounded like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Now they were staying in Jerusalem, God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. When they heard this sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment because each one heard them speaking in his own language. Utterly amazed, they asked, "Are not all these men who were speaking Galileans? Then how is it that we, each of us, hears them in his own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt, and the parts of Libya near Cyrene. Visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs. We hear them declaring the wonders of God in our own tongues. Amazed and perplexed, they ask one another, "What does this mean?" Some, however, made fun of them and said, "They have had too much wine." Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice and addressed the crowd. "Fellow Jews and all of you who lived in Jerusalem, let me explain this to you. Listen carefully to what I say. These men are not drunk, as you suppose. It is only 9 in the morning. No, this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and this will prophesy. I will show wonders in the heaven above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and billows of smoke. The sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the great and glorious day of the Lord, and everyone who calls in the name of the Lord will be saved. Amen.
Thank you very much, Don. Melanie, come in with a second reading.
Now about the gifts of the Spirit. Brothers and sisters, I do not want you to be uninformed. You know that when you were pagan, somehow or other, you were influenced and led astray to mute idols. Therefore, I want you to know that no one who is speaking by the Spirit of God says Jesus be cursed, and no one can say Jesus is Lord, except by the Holy Spirit. There are different kinds of gifts, but the same Spirit distributes them. There are different kinds of service, but the same Lord. There are different kinds of working, but in all of them and in everyone, it is the same God at work. Now to each one of the manifestation of the Spirit is given for the common good. To one, there is given through the Spirit a message of wisdom. To another, a message of knowledge by means of the same Spirit. To another, faith by the same Spirit. To another, gifts of healing by that one Spirit. To another, miraculous powers. To another, prophecy. To another, distinguishing between spirits. To another, speaking in different kinds of tongues. And to still another, the interpretation of tongues. All these are the work of one and the same Spirit, and he distributes them to each one, just as he determines. Just as a body, though one has many parts, but all its many parts form one body, so it is with Christ. For we were all baptized but one Spirit, so as to form one body, whether Jews or Gentiles, slave or free, and we were all given the one Spirit to drink.
Thank you very much, Melanie. We've heard of the gifts of the Spirit. And now we will join together to sing the hymn, "Upon the Day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit Came." Thank you. Holy Spirit is here in the world today, just like he was in the days of the apostles. Let's open our hearts to him. Before we go on to the sermon, I'd like for us to watch a short clip about the day of Pentecost.
You will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. Go into the world and preach the gospel to all creation.
No money, no silver, no gold. But what I have, I give you in the name of Jesus of Nazareth. Rise up and walk. Through Jesus, that this man walks again. God sent us his servant, Jesus, and God raised him again from death. We are his witnesses, and the Holy Spirit is with us and makes us strong.
Jesus is alive.
Well, you saw that the Holy Spirit, before he came, all these people could pray was, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come." And there are people like that. All they know to pray is to recite the Lord's Prayer. It's not bad. But when the Holy Spirit comes on you, it's a different ball game. Prayer becomes something powerful. Before the Holy Spirit came, these guys were hiding and crying. Now they went out there, transformed, changed, revolutionized, to go and declare the mighty power of Christ. Now, what you saw about the cripple being raised, it's not a legend. It is fact. It is true. I can give you my own example. About 10, 15 years ago, I woke up one morning and my wife was lying down in bed. I didn't know there was anything wrong with her. But then later on, I saw she was lying paralyzed. She barely managed to whisper and say to me, "Joe, help me." She couldn't move. Her eyes were glazed, watching the ceiling. I went over to her, tried to lift her up. She was completely helpless. I managed to lift her up. In those days, she didn't have as much weight as she has now. So I managed to lift her up. When I tried to let her stand, her legs were twisted, her arms were twisted. It was an ugly sight. And I just knew that she was having a stroke. And I said, "In the name of Jesus, you spirit of stroke, I rebuke you to leave this body now. Receive your healing." And she was instantly healed. Instantly. We didn't go to the hospital. We didn't have to call the doctor. I've seen miracles like that with my family, with other church members, with other people. The power of the Spirit is real. The Holy Spirit is with us today. Let us pray. Father, as we study the working of the Spirit, the gifts of the Spirit, oh Lord, speak to us. Enable us by your Spirit to understand, to believe, and to receive your counsels. Open my lips and give me utterance. Anoint our ears to listen and touch our hearts to receive your truth. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, many people have argued that the gifts of the Spirit have been withdrawn. We just read about the gifts of the Spirit. The Holy Spirit, when he comes into our lives, brings many, many things. Many, many things. And we can't talk about all. But one of the things that the Holy Spirit brings is that he brings us the gifts of the Spirit. The Holy Spirit brings us the gifts of the Spirit. And some people have argued that the gifts of the Spirit have been withdrawn. They are no longer operating. And they say so because we don't see the gifts of the Spirit anymore working amongst us. And because we don't see the gifts of the Spirit working amongst us, they imagine that the gifts of the Spirit have been withdrawn. But this is not true. We Methodists like to hear what Wesley has to say. So let me read for you what Wesley says on the gifts of the Spirit. You can check this if you Google John Wesley on the gifts of the Spirit. You can read this for yourself. And he says, the cause of the decline of the spiritual gift was not because there was no more occasion for them. This is a miserable mistake. The real cause was the love of many, almost all of Christian so-called was wax cold. That is, Christians don't love God anymore. The Christian had no more of the Spirit of Christ than other heathens. Christians are not filled with the Spirit, are not walking in the Spirit, are not listening to the Spirit. They are just like other people who don't have the Holy Spirit. And he says, the Son of Man, when he came to examine his church, could hardly find faith upon earth. This was the real cause why the extraordinary gifts of the Holy Ghost were no longer to be found. The Christians were turned heathen again and had only a dead form of religion left. So Wesley says that Christians are just like unbelievers, and that their faith, whatever faith they had, is just as if it's a form. It's only a form that they have, not the real thing. And that is the reason why Christians are not seeing the gifts of the Spirit. Now, the writer continues to say, Wesley's assertion on the gifts and manifestation of the Spirit was not merely theoretical. His insistence upon the gifts of the Spirit stemmed out of the early days of the Methodist Revival, where many individuals in London, Oxford, Bristol reported supernatural healings, visions, dreams, spiritual impressions, power in evangelizing, extraordinary bestowment of wisdom, and so on. So this is something that really happened in the early days of the Methodist Revival. We hardly see that in the Methodist Church today. And if you read, you find out that many writers say that Wesley is the father of modern day Pentecostalism and charismatic movements, because what is happening among the charismatics and the Pentecostals actually started with John Wesley. Now, these gifts of the Spirit that we read about, what are they? They are divine supernatural abilities given by the Spirit to believers in Christ for the edification of the church. Now, I want to distinguish between spiritual gifts and natural talents. A natural talent is something that anybody can have. You can be a Muslim, you can be a Buddhist, you can be anybody. We are all creatures of God, and God has endowed us all with abilities. So you don't need to be a Christian in order to have a natural talent. But the gifts of the Spirit that we're talking about, they are given only to those who have believed in Christ and have the Holy Spirit in them. So there's a difference between spiritual gifts and natural talents. Now, these gifts are not something that you can do yourself. So you don't have to worry about, I can't do it. Oh, me, I can't do it. The gifts are called manifestations of the Spirit. The Spirit of God dwells in you. And if you are in tune with the Spirit of God, then the Spirit can manifest himself. You know, if I'm in this house, I can start singing and everybody will hear that somebody is singing. I can go and sit on my organ and start playing the organ. And somebody say, who is that playing the organ? And they say, that is Reverend. I can turn on my television. Who has turned on the television? They say, that's Reverend. So I can manifest myself in this house in many ways. So the Holy Spirit is within us. And one way by which he manifests himself is these gifts. He manifests himself. It is not something you do. It's something the Holy Spirit does through you, if you will allow him. Now, the gifts that were mentioned as we read 1 Corinthians 12, 1 to 13, 9 gifts were mentioned. Actually, there are many other gifts of the Spirit, and we can't talk about all of them now. even what is in 1 Corinthians 12, I doubt if we can really, you know, talk about all of them this morning. But I'll do my best. First of all, they talk about the utterance of wisdom, or other versions call it the word of wisdom. Now, this is a supernaturally given wisdom in a moment of time to solve a problem, or supernaturally given wisdom to understand God's word and apply it in a very practical way. Now, an example of word of wisdom in the life of Jesus was when they brought to him a woman caught in adultery. And they asked him, "What shall we do? The law of Moses said we should stone this man, this woman. What do you say?" Now, Jesus was in a very tight place. The reason is that at the time, the Jews were under Roman rule. And the Romans had made a law which said the Jews could not carry out the capital punishment except with the permission of the Roman governor. So if Jesus gave them the go-ahead to stone the woman, he would come directly into conflict with the Roman governor. He would be arrested for breaking the law. If Jesus said, "Don't stone the woman," they'll say, "That man does not believe in Moses." You know, Moses was a great man of the Jews. And Jesus himself had taught them that Moses was from God and that they had to do what Moses said. So if Jesus said, "Don't stone him," then they will say, "That guy doesn't believe in Moses. He's not from God. He's a deceiver." So he was caught between the devil and the deep blue sea. He had to get out of that problem. And the Holy Spirit gave him what we call the word of wisdom. He said, "He that is without sin amongst you, let him cast the first stone." And then he bowed down his head and he was writing on the floor. We don't know what he wrote, but one humorous minister have suggested that Jesus was writing down the names of the girlfriends of those who were standing there. So when you saw your girlfriend's name, then you left. You know, they couldn't catch Jesus because of the word of knowledge. Sorry, the word of wisdom. There are other examples you can find, Matthew 22, 17 to 21. You can check Nathan and David. I can't talk about all of them because of time. Then we have the utterance of knowledge. Other versions call it the word of knowledge. Again, this can mean having supernatural knowledge in the things of God, in the scriptures. But it can also mean having knowledge that you could not have had, and using it for the benefit of the church. I'll give you an example. There was a guy who came to talk to me one day, and he told me how he became a member of the church where I was, you know, preaching. I was then in St. Mark's, Tottenham, St. Mark's Methodist Church, Tottenham. And he said somebody invited him to church. And when he came to church, I was the one preaching. And after I had finished preaching, he went to the one who invited him, and he was very angry with him. He said to him, "Why did you go and tell the preacher all about me, all my secrets, everything I was doing? You are a bad man. Why should you do that?" And that friend of him said to him, "I've never even talked to that preacher. I know he comes to the church there, but I have never met him. I've never talked to him. I like his preaching, that's why I invited you. I have never talked to him. He doesn't even know me, and he doesn't know you. So whatever it is that you heard, that was the Holy Spirit speaking to you." And he became so convicted and convinced, he became a permanent member of the church, became very active in the church. That's the word of knowledge being used to talk about a person and bring him to Christ. An example in the Bible is Ananias and Sapphira, where Ananias and Sapphira wanted to deceive Peter and the apostles. And Peter knew that Ananias and Sapphira were telling lies and confronted them with their sin. That's word of knowledge. You know things that you could never have known by yourself for a good purpose by the Holy Spirit. And the third one is distinguishing. You see, I have put these categories together. There are nine of them, but I've put them together in various categories. So these first three, we call them the revelatory gifts because they reveal things, okay? So the third one among the revelatory gifts is the gift of discerning of spirits, or other versions call it distinguishing between spirits. Now, there are different kinds of spirits. Angels are spirits. Demons are spirit. The human being is a spirit, and the Holy Spirit is a spirit. So when that gift is operating, you are able to distinguish between spirits. So you can enter into a room and you will see only human beings. Another person enters into the room and you will see among the human beings that some of them are not human beings, some of them are angels. A person who has the ability to distinguish between spirits can tell when somebody is operating with the Holy Spirit, or he's operating with a demon spirit, or he's operating merely with the human spirit. You know, the Bible talks of men, prophets who prophesy by their own spirit, okay? And there are people who prophesy by the Holy Spirit. And there are people who talk by spirits of demons. A good example is in Acts 16, Paul and Silas were preaching somewhere, and a woman was following them. What the woman was saying was perfectly correct, but the woman was operating with a demon spirit. And there was, you know, the Bible says that demons can come like angels of light. So the woman was saying good things about the people, about Paul and Silas, but he was speaking by a demon spirit. And then Paul discerned, or he managed to know by the spirit, that woman was operating with a demon spirit, and he commanded the demon spirit to come out. Now, carefully, I want you to be careful about this gift, because some people are merely suspicious and they claim they have the gift of discerning of spirit. One man of God said, some people claim to have the gift of discerning of spirit and all they have is the gift of suspicion. Now, this is different from having discernment. Discernment is simply the ability to have good judgment. We are all to have discernment, making good judgment. But the gift of discerning of spirit, not discernment, but the discerning of spirits, the ability to distinguish between different spirits. It's similar to, if you talk about utterance of wisdom, for instance, we are all supposed to have wisdom. Every Christian must have wisdom. But then this gift of the utterance of wisdom is a special gift that is given to you in a moment of time. So the gift of discernment of spirit is not the same as discernment. Every one of us must have good discernment to make good judgments. Now, the inspirational gifts, I will not talk about them because of time, and also because of the fact that they generate a lot of questions. So if you are interested, join us in our Wednesday teaching, and we shall find time and deal with the inspirational gifts, prophecy, diversity of tongues, interpretation of tongues. Because of time and because of the fact that they generate a lot of questions and interest, you can join us on Wednesday and we can discuss it in detail. Now go to the power gifts, gifts of healing. Healing is a gift. Somebody will say, oh, now we have modern science and modern medicine. You wait until the doctor tells you that he can't do anything about your sickness. Then you will know that you need the gift of healing. Look, I have met lots of Christian doctors, good doctors, competent doctors, and they all tell me, Joe, we doctors, we don't heal. We only help. We only manage. The real healing is from God. Any doctor worth his salt knows this, that they don't heal. Healing is from God. So the gift of healing is still in operation today. It's working. I told you about how I prayed for my wife and she was healed. You know, my second born was sick unto death. He had what we call cerebral malaria. And they were giving him medication, no response. He was going down, down, down. He looked the very picture of death. One night, I just got on my knees and took hold of God. I really had it out with God. And I slept. When I slept, I dreamed. And in the dream, I descended into the lower part of the earth. And then when I got into the lower part of the earth, I was moving along. There were many compartments there. And I was moving along those compartments. Then I got to one compartment, and by a certain force, I stopped at that compartment. And I put my hands into those compartments and took hold of something. And I pulled it out. And when I pulled it out, I saw that I was holding my son. And I walked out from the underground world and climbed up on top of the earth. And I put my son down and he walked. And the next day, he was instantly healed. The gifts of the Spirit, they are still in operation. The doctors were doing their best for my son, but they couldn't. But the gift of healing saved him. He would have been, in fact, in the realm of the Spirit, he was dead. He was gone. But by the operation of the gift of the Spirit, he came back to life. So the gift of healing, they are still there. Working of miracles. You see, healing has to do with sickness. But working of miracles is not necessarily sickness, although it could be sickness. You could be dealing with impossible situations. Because of time, I can't talk about it, but just one example, somebody who is clinically proven to be barren, he has no ovaries or no fallopian tubes. I've heard of such examples. People have laid hands on them and they got their fallopian tubes and they gave birth. That's not healing, that's a miracle, doing the impossible things. Then the gift of faith. You see, every one of us must have faith. But there is a certain faith that is required to do some very impossible things. And again, I can't talk much about it, but I'll give you one example. In the 19th century, there was a man called John Mueller. You can Google him, John Mueller, go to Google and put in John Mueller. He has written a book called Answers to Prayer, and you can find out what that man did. Now, this man, he went to God and said, God, I want to show the world that Jesus is alive. And what I want to do is to build an orphanage. I'm not telling you a story. This is a true fact with documentaries on it. I want to show the world that Christ is alive. And what I want to do is to build an orphanage. In those days, the welfare system was not operating. So there were a lot of children on the streets, homeless children, that kind of thing. I want to build an orphanage to take care of every poor child that I see. And I am not going to ask any human being for one penny. George Miller prayed for 1 year, and God said to him, do it. You can do it. And you know what? At the end of about 50 years of his ministry, George Miller had taken care of over 10,000 children. He had built over 100 schools. He has spent over $100 million in that work. And George Mueller never asked a human being for a penny. Every food, every whatever he needed came in answer to prayer. He did not speak to any human being. Sometimes in some of the orphanages, he will get up and there'll be no food. And he will tell the children, Jesus told us if we pray, he will answer. Come and sit down. Then they will come and sit down in the dining hall. They will spread out, the place and the cutlery. And they say, children, let us pray and talk to God. By the time they will finish praying, there'll be bread, there'll be milk. People will bring it in. It doesn't rain from heaven. No, not manna. But people will bring in bread and milk and whatever. It was fantastic. Now, you can't do that with normal faith. It is the gift, the special gift of faith. Now, these gifts are still there for us to have them. We don't see them. So sometimes people find Christianity very boring and very irrelevant. because they don't see the power of God, the move of God, the hand of God. Well, number one, if you want the gift of the Spirit, number one, you must be a true Christian with the Spirit of God in you. 1 Corinthians 12:31 says that you must earnestly desire the gifts. Some people desire everything but the things of the Spirit. You must have a strong desire to see these gifts at work for the glory of God, not for your glorification. 1 Corinthians 14:1 says that pursue love and desire spiritual gifts. In other words, if you want to move in a spiritual gift, you have to move in the realm of God. Now, the realm of God is the realm of the miraculous. And the realm of God is love. If you don't work in love, you are not working with God. It doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter whether you are a preacher or a pastor or whatever. Anyone who does not work in love people, pray for people, forgive people, think well of people. If you don't work in love, you are not working in God. And if you are not working in God, you are not going to have the things of God. And John 15:7 says that if you abide in me, my words abide in you, you can ask for anything. Now, anything includes the gifts of the Spirit. If you are in Christ, abiding in him and walking in him and depending on him and allowing him to fill you, you can ask for the gifts of the Spirit and he will give them to you. Now, Luke 16:10-13, you can go and read that. But it says there that he who is faithful in little things is faithful in big things. If you are not faithful in little things, God will not give you the big things. Are you faithful in your house, in your duties as a husband towards your wife and towards your children? Are you faithful in your duties as a wife towards your husband and towards your children? Are you faithful as a child in your home? Whatever work you're supposed to do at home as a child, do you do it? Are you faithful in your work? Are you faithful in the little things that God has entrusted to you? Are you faithful in prayer? Some people have found it difficult to be faithful in little things like going to church. If you are not faithful in little things, God is not going to give you the big things. And then he says that if you are not faithful in handling natural things, you can go and study the passage. So people are not faithful in handling money. You know, God expects that some of your money, you should use it to take care of the poor. Some people, when they get money, all they think about is themselves. They never think of helping anybody. And the last thing he says here is that you can't serve God and serve money. I don't have enough time, my dear friends, but some people are motivated by money. It doesn't matter what it means. You will take extra hours. I'm not talking about those in the front line, like doctors and pharmacists and nurses who have to go to church, go to work by all means. But, you know, if you listen to Manasseh's message last week, he mentioned this, that some people allow the devil to use work to keep them away from God. You know, he will take extra hours and he becomes so busy and so bogged down. He can't pray. He can't read his Bible. He can't go to church. He will take a new job that will make sure that new job is, he has to go to work every Sunday. He doesn't care, you know. So the things of the natural things that God has given you, you are not faithful with it. And so you are unable to serve God. Don't get me wrong. I'm not saying you shouldn't work. Everybody must work, right? But do you care about your spiritual life? Do you care about the things of God? So you can go to God in prayer and say, God, my work is keeping me from praying. My work is keeping me from church. Can you help me? Make a way for me. And if you have to take extra hours, you know, I have worked as in the secular world long before I became a minister. And even when I became a minister, I was still working in the secular world. I was a manager. And when I came to this country, I worked in the secular world. There are many hours I turned down because it will keep me from praying. It will keep me from going to church. And there are many Christians who don't care at all. If they are being kept away from God, it doesn't matter to them. Well, God says if you do that, money has become your master, and he is not your master. You cannot have money to be your master and God to be your master. If God is not your master, he's not going to give you gifts. And don't get me wrong, I didn't say you shouldn't work. If your work is saying that you must go to work, do go. But if your work is keeping you from spiritual growth, let me tell you, spiritual things are far more important than natural things. And you get to get down on your knees and say, God, help me out. I need to grow spiritually. I need to pay attention to spiritual things. The gifts of the Spirit are for us today. Many people are enjoying them, using them to bless humanity, to bless their homes. In fact, without the gifts of the Spirit in my home, maybe my wife would have been dead, or my children, some of them would have been cripples. I'm telling you, I don't have time to tell you everything. But the gifts of the Spirit are real, and the Holy Spirit brings them to us. Now, the gifts of the Spirit that I've talked about, they are just a tiny bit of the things that the Holy Spirit does in the life of people. There is so much that the Holy Spirit wants to do for us if we will open up to Him and allow Him to control our life, if we will study the Scriptures, if we will pray, if we will fast, if we will seek His face. The gifts of the Spirit are for you today. We will now enter into a time. We will sing this song, Holy Spirit, too divine. We shall sing the first, the fifth, and the sixth stanzas, and then we will pray. Coordinator will call your names as we pray.
If Don could please pray for us.
Okay. Lord, on this glorious day, we are truly sorry for our transgressions. We pray that we understand what your words means to us and what works you've shown us, what you want us to do. Your written word is simple, just as your commandments are simple to understand in any language. You told us to love your neighbors as yourself. Have no other God but me. Love me as I have loved you. In all your readings and teachings, your words couldn't have been simpler. Yet still, with what's happening in the world today, we seem to have lost the basic commandments. Let us remind each other by action to love one another as we have loved ourselves. But before that, we have to get to love ourselves and get ourselves right with you, Father God. Let us use this opportunity to continue following the gifts of the Spirit in praising and loving the Holy Spirit always, as He is looking after us always. Continue to bless the Reverend and his family and all of us each day. Amen.
Amen.
If Melanie could please pray for us.
Dear God, thank you for the promise that whoever asks will receive and whoever seeks will find. I know that I need more of you in my life. I know that I need more of the fruits of your Holy Spirit in my life. God, I pray that you will fill our heart with the blessing of your Holy Spirit. I pray that the Holy Spirit would lead and guide us in all things, and that we would listen to the gentle prompting of his voice as we read your word or commune with you in prayer. Give us the grace to recognize his still small voice as we search through the scripture each day. As crisis is shaking our world, we turn to you with all our worries for our loved ones, for societies, for job, and for the economy, and for the most vulnerable amongst us will be affected. Transform uncertainty and fear into love and care. Give us courage, wisdom, and consolation as we face the hard realities which comfort us in life around the world today. Fill us with all the joy and peace as we believe in you. You know all our pain and anxiety very well. Help us to rest in your comfort today. Holy Spirit, empower our life to produce your fruit of love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Only through your power can we live in holiness and in victory over our sin. I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
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 If tomorrow could please pray for us.
Please pray for us.
Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you this day as we pray regarding this coronavirus pandemic. Father, we thank you for the UK. Thank you because the graph of this pandemic and infections is on the downward slope. And we thank you because we are seeing the end of this pandemic in Jesus' name. Father, we just worship your holy name. Lord, we pray for the government and for those in authority, that Lord, you will give them your knowledge and revelation and inspiration so that they will make the right decisions regarding easing the lockdown and bringing things back to normal again, so that our lives in this country will be normalized and we will give full praise to you in Jesus' name. Lord, regarding this pandemic, we pray for South America, Brazil especially, that is being said to be the current epicenter of this disease. Lord, we ask that in your mercy, you will stay the hand of this pandemic in those areas in Jesus' name. Father, we ask that, oh Lord, you will turn around every form of ailment that's already taking place and bring healing. We pray that, Lord, you will encourage the medical health system and everyone involved. You will raise up resources, Lord God, from everywhere, such that the people in that nation will know that, Lord, you have sent help to them in Jesus' name. We pray for every aspect of the world, in Africa, in Asia, Australia, America, where they have gone over 100,000 deaths. Father, we pray, in your mercy, intervene. We ask that, oh Lord, you will purge out this pandemic from the nations of the world. And Lord God, in the end of this, we will all come to give glory again to your name in the name of Jesus. We just thank you. We worship your holy name. For as many as are grieving, we pray that, Lord, you will comfort them. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Amen.
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 If a leader could please pray for us.
God, you know what we are going through, and we are thankful you can take the hardest circumstances and turn it around for our good and your glory. You can restore all things. So we are asking you to restore lost jobs, finances, relationships, resources, and hopes. Show anyone struggling financially that you are holding them close, and surround them with people who will help them through this difficult time. Please meet their immediate needs, as I trust you for long-term solutions. Turn fear into faith as your good plans for them unfold. As they wait on you, renew their hope and give them the courage to dream again. Remind them of their value and fill them with peace. We also ask that you give our government leaders discernment, strength, and resolve so they can continue to guide us through this troubling time. give them wisdom about what needs to be done to stabilize the economy and navigate through this economic uncertainty. Give our civic leaders inspiration, courage, joy, and strength to meet the needs of their communities in this troubled time. Our God, come and do what only you can do. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
If Shelter could be, please pray for us.
Father, we thank you for this message that you have given us today on this day of your Pentecostal power. Thank you for a message so clear that it clears all our doubts, our suspicions, and every confusion that has come our way. We pray today that your word, that your spirit is God himself, the person of the Holy Spirit in us, will become more real to us. Let your spirit, who lives in us because he is God, give us the spirit of power that you promised. Because your word says, and we shall receive power when the Holy Spirit is come upon us. Your church has been weak because as individuals we have been weak. The church has been doubting because we have little faith. And as Wesley says, we have waxed cold in our love. Today we are praying that your power will begin to manifest. Let us begin to love you. Let us begin to believe you. Let us begin to take the step. Let's read your word and be ready and say, Lord, empower us that we begin to see your power at work in us. Lord, you do not lie. Every promise you made in the scriptures, in the Old Testament, God fulfilled about the coming of Christ, about salvation. And Joel chapter 2 was fulfilled in Acts chapter 2, that our children and our parents and the old will have dreams and see visions. We pray today that this day will be a special day in the life of us individuals and as congregations and as a circuit and as a whole Methodist church and as the whole church of God. That we are in the last days and you promise you pour out your spirit upon all flesh. We are all flesh and weak. So endue us with your power once more, that the glory of the church, the glory of the latter house shall exceed that of the former one. Lord, by your Pentecostal power, minister to us. Let every one of us recognize, realize, discover, rediscover the gifts that you have bestowed upon us. That we begin to have dreams from today. We begin to have visions. We begin to pray for others. We begin to discern spirits. We will have the spirit of faith to pray and have miracles. And Lord, that our joy be restored. Because your word says, when we pray and we receive answers, our joy will become full. Cause us, Lord, to have a renewed spirit of prayer in our individual lives. The disciples, the frightened ones, were afraid, locked up for 10 days, desperately afraid and scared to death, as we are, many people are scared to death of Corona these days. But we are praying that we will use these days to wait upon you, include like the early disciples, until your power comes out. That when we come out of this time of waiting, O Lord, we shall be like the day of Pentecost. We will go out, we will face every challenge, the persecution, the mockery, even in the church. People will say, what has happened to you? Are you drunk? But Lord, may your Holy Spirit, who you poured on the disciples, make us like Peter, make us like Paul, make us like the early disciples, make us like Stephen's, that we will rise up in power and show forth your glory. Grant us also your spirit of peace, because the Holy Spirit gives us peace. Grant us the spirit of praise, that even in the prisons of life, like Paul and Silas, we will be singing praises, and then we will see your power descend. because praise is unto you. Lord, we thank you for today. It's such a special day in our lives. It's a memorable day. We know you are not deaf. We know you hear our prayers. We know you have begun a good work in us today, that the church is restored to its former glory. We bless you. We worship you. We adore you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Wonderful prayers. I know God has heard us, and God is renewing us and refreshing us. We bring our service to a close with us, him, our blessed Redeemer, ere he breathe his tender last farewell. Few moments as we think of the Holy Spirit in our lives, the great privilege and the great responsibility of the Holy Spirit in our lives. Lord, pour your Spirit upon us. O Lord, make your Spirit rest upon us. Lord, let the fire of your Spirit burn and blaze in our hearts and in our lives. Lord, surround us with your Spirit. Make us more than conquerors by your Spirit. Make us joyful and peaceful by your Spirit. Make us obedient and holy by your Spirit. And make us work the works of God by your Spirit. Let us overcome every sickness, every disease, every lack and need and poverty, every fear, by the mighty working of your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' holy name, and all shall say, amen. Thank you very much for worshiping with us. Wednesday, 7 p.m. Not 7:30, 7 p.m. We shall meet for our Bible study and prayer. We'll try and finish Psalm 91 this week, and then maybe we can move into the gifts of the Spirit and the other operations of the Spirit. So Wednesday, 7 p.m., you are all very much welcome. So glad of you. God bless you abundantly for coming.
Thank you, Reverend. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, sir.
Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you.